Okay, so before I begin, it's imperative that I tell you all about my friend Naina. You know, like Naina. And while I'm at it, I want all of you to do something that you're all very good at. Judge. I want all of you to judge your way to glory when I tell you about Naina. So my friend Naina is a complainer. She constantly complains about not having enough clothes in the wardrobe, despite the walk-in closet being full. She complains about ghar ka khana not being good enough, which is why she'll order every second day. And while she fills her belly with pizza, she doesn't forget to fill the dustbin too. It's a big problem when her driver doesn't show up. I mean, taking an Uber is quite an inconvenience, right? But worst of all is when her household help, Coco Bhaiya, doesn't come for work. You can't possibly expect her to wash her own dishes or serve herself food for that matter. According to me, Naina is a papa ki princess. According to Naina, as she often says, her life sucks. But does it, really? Hi, I'm Eshaa, and today I'm going to speak to you about privilege. Privilege is something that most of us enjoy. Although to varying degrees, its existence is undeniable. The real question, however, is how many of us actually value it? The idea of privilege has been very close to my heart for multiple reasons. For starters, I think college acts as a revelation. You finally begin to understand the world a little better. You're aware and conscious of structures in society that result in oppression. You know what they mean when they say the world is a dark place. There have been innumerable times where I felt outraged or bothered by some kind of injustice in society. And it's in precisely these moments that I find myself reflecting on my privilege. But on a more personal note, the idea of privilege is close to my heart because of my context. My mother belongs to a very small town in Madhya Pradesh, and my father to a very small village. Mine is one of those stories where both my parents have worked really hard and made it big in life. As a result, my brother and I have had to face no problems whatsoever. It's precisely because of this that at home, I'm often reminded to respect the benefits that I have because my parents had to work really hard to give me the comfortable life that I lead. Now, while I truly understand that I am in a position of advantage and I respect all my privileges, there always seems to be one dilemma. I'm not quite sure whether trying to understand is ever enough to grasp the gravity of your unearned benefits. Whether you can truly value your privilege, or whether I can truly value my privilege as much as probably my parents do, because they had to experience deprivation, and I haven't experienced any of that. So today, I'm going to share with you a couple of experiences and stories that I've had in the past that have gotten me closer to understanding this notion. I recently had the opportunity to visit several villages in Madhya Pradesh while I helped my father, a member of the Legislative Assembly, during his electoral campaign. The experience was extremely overwhelming. The extent and scale of poverty, economic deprivation, social backwardness, illiteracy was shocking. It's not like you don't read about these things in the newspapers, but to witness all of it firsthand is when it hits you, and it was a rude shock. Two instances in particular really stayed with me. First, I remember meeting this 16-year-old girl, Sunita, who had been married off and had to discontinue her education. I couldn't help but feel ashamed of how we at JMC complain about petty things like not having air conditioners in college, or how I bunked classes because I found the teacher too boring. Maybe in reality, I never tried hard enough to listen or invest in learning. I have the privilege of receiving an education in the first place, of having a college that I come to where teachers turn up in the classrooms to teach me. However, my more important realization was that of my freedom. I have the privilege of freedom. I understand that as a woman, I will and do face the brunt of patriarchy. But on that ladder of emancipation, I still claim a higher spot than Sunita does. I still face a lesser oppression than Sunita does, which is why it becomes essential for me to value that freedom And more importantly, utilize that freedom responsibly. My other observation was of caste equations in the villages. Now, the caste system in India is a hierarchical arrangement in society, which has evolved over the years out of the Varna system and the Jati system or occupational groups. And your rank in this hierarchy is determined by beliefs in ritual purity and pollution. As residents of urban areas, we often tend to dismiss the question of caste. We choose to be caste blind, whereas in reality, it is an all-pervasive ideology. It might have more implicit manifestations in an urban area than possibly a rural backdrop where it is more explicit, but it exists nonetheless. So in every village that I visited, there was a separate settlement for the Dalits or the scheduled castes. So while the entire village would live together in one corner, a little further away in a segregated area were these people from the scheduled castes. I couldn't help but think about all these complaints about reservations that did the rounds when I was applying for Delhi University, or that do the rounds often, you know, every day. Is it really fair for me to complain that someone does not have enough merit when they have been subjected to exclusion their entire lives? Is it my sense of entitlement that makes me feel that I deserve that spot more than someone else does? I remember as a child, every time my grandmother would visit me in the city, I noticed that she would never eat or drink anything in my house. It was only a few years back that I realized that she did so because my household help was from a lower caste. While there is absolutely no justification for her actions, I can only tell you about her context. My grandmother is an extremely orthodox lady who has lived her entire life in a village. The caste system, the hierarchy, the untouchability are a mindset and a lifestyle, not only for my grandmother, but for millions of Indians out there. I have the privilege of basic human dignity, which is deprived to multiple people of this country. I am entitled because I do not have someone standing to destroy my self-worth and reduce me to something lesser than a human being. This brings me to ask a very fundamental question. What is privilege anyway? Is it just economic affluence? I believe the answer is not so simple. Privilege flows in many ways. It can be from your identity, your gender identity. Being a man puts you in a position of privilege. Being cisgendered puts you in a position of privilege. It can be your racial or ethnic identity, it can be your caste identity. Physical and mental well-being are also being privileged. These days, to have a clean environment is to be in a position of privilege. To have a safe working space is to have privilege. To have a safe environment at home is to have privilege. And I can name a dozen other things. Funnily enough, to even complain is a privilege that only few have. It was about 2 months ago that my household help did not show up for work. Since I do not know how to cook, I just ate bread and went off to sleep. The next day that she came, in a rather annoyed tone, I asked her, "Why did you not come to work?" And she said, her 16-year-old daughter had gone missing. For the next 15 days, I watched that lady come to work every single day. Let's leave aside the fact that she couldn't have, like, filing an FIR did not do much help to her. What hit me the most was that she did not have the luxury to weep. She did not have the luxury to weep for possibly the greatest loss of her life because she couldn't afford to skip work, her only means of livelihood. Well, having spoken enough of privilege, I will also talk a little about my oppression. The other day, my best friend and I were discussing our applications to colleges abroad. So you know how you're supposed to write your essays and your statements of purposes, right? She told me that the best feedback that you could possibly get is from your parents. For 2 seconds, I just thought to myself, being the first generation English-speaking member of my family, I do not have the privilege to ask my parents to review my applications or my essays. despite of the fact that they have provided for me in every possible way, this is just something that they couldn't do because of the circumstances of their lives. But this wasn't the first time I felt left out. So you know when you enter new spaces, like a new college or like a new school, and you start to make new friends, there are often certain things that you tend to bond on. So it could be music, it could be literature, it could be movies, it could be the kind of clothes that you like to wear. A lot of times it has happened that I find myself feeling left out when my friends discuss bands like The Queen or The Beatles, or talk about singers like a Frank Sinatra or a Bob Dylan, because I was never introduced to these artists. Now these tastes and choices that we as people have, as individuals, these choices and these tastes that we have can either be self-acquired or are inherited and passed down to us from our families. And it's what you call cultural capital. Cultural capital is a social asset that determines your social standing and your social mobility. So things like education, intellect, skill set, behavior, tastes and choices, your sense of aesthetic, are all what constitute cultural capital and are inherited from our families. To explain this a little better, let me take an example. Even if I am more economically well off than a friend of mine, the fact that she has generations in her family that have been English speaking gives her that added benefit. She has the privilege of inheriting cultural capital, whereas I have to work hard for it, which is probably why at the age of 6, I was sent to an English-speaking boarding school. I believe all of us as individuals have our own share of struggles and our own share of privileges. My underlying motive today is to ask you all to pay heed to that privilege. As people in contemporary times, we are obsessed with this culture of complaining. Since a sob story sells, we tend to exaggerate our struggles, and all those benefits seem minuscule in comparison. I truly believe to be able to value privilege, you need to first acknowledge it. And you acknowledge it by taking into cognizance your entitlement, by recognizing that you are in a position of power. The moment you choose to be ignorant, you also become irresponsible. You're irresponsible towards the higher position that you have in society, which someone else is deprived of. But worse off, you know, in the state of ignorance, we often tend to become insensitive. If I can't see that I'm better off, then I also can't see that there are people that are worse off. And in this process, I kill my ability to empathize with those that face oppression. So before I leave, I'm going to ask all of you to judge again. But this time, I don't want you to judge Naina. I want you to judge how much of a Naina you have within you. It is sometimes the most obvious that becomes the non-obvious and requires our gravest introspection. Thank you.